You're back now at the jack off
house. Yeah, what's up, people? Sorry I left you, you know, waiting. It's a big old break between episodes. But man, since I last recorded a joint, we lost somebody else, man. Last time was Jamie Duffy, you know, it's my man Nate Dogg. So let's have Nate Dogg ride up in on this one right here. Crazy though, man. Man, who made some of the best hooks ever, man? It was Nate Dogg, man. You put him on anything, man. That smooth voice, turn the most gutter gangster stuff ever. It's like silky smooth, awesome. You know, yo, man. Some of what he's saying about wasn't the really best things you want to really say to or about women, but man. Yo. I seen many female get down to a Nate Dogg song. Not dead, just the same. Cause that joint sounds so good. Come on, man. Regulate, man. Come on. That's storytelling, man. You know, ain't no fun, you know, as you heard at the beginning. Classic. Classic, you know what I'm saying? When you met last night, baby, that was the truth, you know. Next episode, that, hold up. You know, area codes with Ludacris. You know, man, that joint was fabulous. Working with Pharrell Marsh and Raucus. You know, so many tracks, you know, even his own joints, you know. It was funny, you know. I remember the first time I heard Sleepy Brown on, you know, back on Southern Playlist on Outkast. I was like, oh man, South got their own Nate Dogg. You know what I'm saying? He's the bar. Singing on hip hop, you know, it was just, he's it, you know, he was it. Now he's gone. Man, 2011, man. Things is changing. You know, pull some out from my man Nate Dogg.
All my real dogs still kicking with me. All my down hoes still tricking with me. All the true gangsters know Nate ain't never loved no gold. All the hood rats still shaking for me. All my true fans still checking for me. All the real smokers know. Ain't passing nothing but dope indeed. Real trees, chronic leaves, no seeds. When I met ya last night, baby, before I blew your mind, blew your mind.
Sorry, man. You know, I found out. Didn't even know this. This year is the 20th anniversary of Street Fighter 2. Now some of you listen to this podcast is like, yo, really? Street Fighter 2? It's been 20 years? Why does this matter? Yo, Street Fighter 2 is important. Dope things happened in 91. Low End Theory happened in 91. I think Nevermind came out in 91. You know. I think Cross Colors was out in 91. Getting close to having Bill Clinton as president. You know, a whole bunch of things. Yeah. X-Men number one. Ooh. Some of you guys, you probably went to the comic shop and, you know, you got your X-Men number one, you read it, you know, you probably chatted up or whatever. Yo, I think I went to my first comic shop around that time or whatever. It was awesome, yes. What was equally awesome was going across the street to the mall, asking for 50 cents, taking said 50 cents, and putting it into the Street Fighter II machine and engaging in combat. Man. Y'all just don't know, man, how that game is so important to my life. The 8 War Warriors. Ryu, Ken, Zangief, E. Honda, Guile, Chun-Li, Dawson, Blanca, the four bosses, Mike Bison, Balrog in the States, you know, Vega, actually called Balrog in Japan, Sagat, the boss of the original Street Fighter, and, you know, and Bison in the States, but Vega in Japan. Man, I think I can go see now, but I'll still remember Quarter Circle Forward Punch. It's for the Hadouken. Man, that right there, that game. See, a lot of people don't understand. It was like arcade games get hit real big in like the late 70s, early 80s. Then it has a big crash. And, you know, games kind of came back. It wasn't really the same. You know, Nintendo rose with the home console. Kind of kicked Atari out. But, yo, Street Fighter 2 helped bring the arcade games back. The fighting games. A lot of you cats was playing your PC games. You probably was playing Wolfenstein 3D. You was probably shooting people and stuff, whatever. Yo, regular people play Street Fighter. You know what I'm saying? Everything was hot. Grunge was hot. You know what I'm saying? Grunge kids, skate kids, hip-hop kids, everybody played Street Fighter. Everybody was putting quarters in, testing their metal. You had to actually talk to people face-to-face. Couldn't be soft. You know what I'm saying? Not like these days. That helped feed the arcade industry for years. It was Street Fighter II Champion Edition, Turbo, aka Hyper Fighting, freaking Super Street Fighter II Turbo. That joint helped make the Super Nintendo beat the Sega Genesis. It's Street Fighter II first. Dag on there, the most accurate thing we saw to date. They had 6 buttons on the controller. They knew, man. So since it has been 20 years, you should go. You know, if you got an old Super Nintendo, old Genesis cartridge, just blow it out, put it in the system, play it. You got it on your phone, play it on your phone. You got PS3 or 360. You know what I'm saying? Go get that Turbo, that Hyper Fighting. But, you know, you get that Super Street Fighter 2, you know, remix. You know, you got the Wii. You go buy the old cartridges. Like, I think $8, virtual console. Play that joint. Relive your memories. You know, you done played it once. It might not have been an arcade. You might have been in Chuck E. Cheese's. You might have been in a Chinese food place. You might have been in a laundromat. You got some Street Fighter 2 in your life. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
the selector, making first pick. Get it on down. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Get it on down. Choose and pick the best one. Get it on down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Get it on down. Selector, making first pick. Get it on down. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Get it on down. Choose and pick the best one. Get it on down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Get it on down. Selector, making first pick. Get it on down. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Get it on down. Choose and pick the best one.
Speaking of game anniversaries, guess what else? Freaking Legend of Zelda is 25 years old. And see, I didn't have a podcast last year. I would have done one for Super Mario Brothers, because you know, Secret Life is a Super Mario Brothers. Legend of Zelda, though, man. That gold cartridge. Yo, that was a game back in the day that people's parents played. You know, people talk about all the in-depth, you know, theories of you know, the heroic journey in Star Wars. You don't get no truer version of heroic journey than in Legend of Zelda. All you know is the hero's name. You know his quest. You really don't. It's 8-bit graphical interpretation. Wasn't even that great back in the day. It's early Nintendo. That's a hero with thousands of faces right there. Ganon, giant pig. It was so captivating. You know, you go to the little dungeons. You get the items. You get the hearts. You get the fairies. You talk. You killing a little beast. You solving the puzzles. Light world, dark world. Man. But yo, Legend of Zelda's the truth. Shigeru Miyamoto is a genius. You know? Legend of Zelda, people. Legend of Zelda. When you're full of life, your sword's so tough, it shoot out lasers. It shoot out laser swords. Come on. Spur this epic tale, past, and future, and ocarinas, and wakers, and twilight princesses. It's all connected. It's still captivating. You know, no matter what happens, that's why they still sell consoles. Because the characters they created are just as timeless as anything else. Just as much as how you play it. You still want to play Link. So they can make Cityvilles and Farmvilles. But yo, Nintendo put out a system with Mario and Link on it. Still gonna sell. No matter what Google, Steve Jobs, Sony, 360 can do. Ain't none of them got none of that. That shit is timeless. So yeah, you know, a little bit of time passed. I jumped on a couple other podcasts while, you know, in the middle of the break. You probably think, like, what? You ain't put out a new episode, but you got time to jump on other podcasts. Yeah, man, people hit me on the Skazite, you know. So yeah, I did it. Talked about two flicks. They already out. You can hear my little talks about it on the Pop Culture Shock website. I talked about Limitless, starring Bradley Cooper and Paul, starring Simon Pegg and Nick Frost. Both films are great. Excellent. You know? Well, I shouldn't say excellent. Limitless is very entertaining. It succeeds in what it's trying to do. A lot of plot holes, some jump in the shark moments. There's moments in which you'll see, it's almost like you see a faint image of a Fonzie water skis on. Just on the water. So, oh, he's about to jump that. Yeah. Paul is just straight up excellent. Great comedy. But really, think about it. How many movies have Simon Pegg and Nick Frost done? You can also throw Space in there. And guess what? Have they failed? Nope. So they didn't fail in this one either. You know, it's just good. Overall, good comedy. Jason Bateman's in it. Kristen Wiig is in it. Bill Hader's in it. Seth Rogen is the voice. Limitless is going to have you thinking, though. Thinking about, like, yo, what if I got a pill that let me use 100% of my brain? And some of the things he was doing, he'd be like, man, I would have done some of those things sooner. I would have just said a third. Me personally, I'm getting private military corporation. Straight up. Then I want, you know, give me private intelligence corporation. You know, I got 100%. Yeah, I'm going full Cobra Commander. Full Cobra Commander, people. The hood and all. Hood and all on the logo. Pulse. You know. And that's just how we do. So, yeah, people. Big Love is over. It's done. Our time with the Henriksen clan is in the past. Won't miss this show. HBO secondly on my show. Man. It was a good finale. You know, some people listened, you know, test the waters, you know, it was pretty big, you know, made some decent NY Times news, you know, NPR, you know, Fresh Air. You know, people didn't like, you know, I guess the fourth season, or maybe even the third season, I liked them both. I like when things get a little bit extra, I should say, because it's television, you know. Not everything can be The Wire with that level of realism. I'm sad to see it go. I'm glad it has some resolution. I'm glad things kind of worked out for Bill. You see a finale, you know what I mean by kind of. I read the New York Times review, and it was a female reviewer, and it was interesting. She had an interesting viewpoint that you're not supposed to like Bill. I was like, really? I kind of like Bill. A little hard-headed at times. A little bit too sure of his ideals, but I still like the guy. He tries to do the right thing. He literally tries to do the actual right thing. Then, you know, this interview with the creators, and, you know, they said some things about, like, how, like, women don't really like Bill's character. I was like, really? Is it just a polygamy? Is it him having three wives? Is that just something they can't get over? Because I know a lot of women watch Sopranos. And I think James Gandolfini actually, you know, was a sex symbol of sorts. But, you know, he actually did kill people. He did very, very bad things. You know, but he had issues. Maybe it's because he had issues. He wanted to seek help. A lot of women like Don Draper and Mad Men, too. Very, very misogynistic. He doesn't have three wives, but he always keeps a mistress. And at times, a mistress for the mistress. So, is it that because they can see the vulnerability? That no matter, like, they're flawed, and they do mess up things to women. But the fact that they're openly flawed and they try to seek help and they're open about their issues with men, with Bill, is kind of just old school patriarch. And he does have his problems, but, you know, he chose to marry three women. I don't know. I'm still working that thoughts out. Great show. Sad it's gone. Great finale. If you haven't watched it, catch it. If you've never seen the show, I think you should go check it out. You know, rent the DVDs on Netflix or something. It's awesome. Great acting. Interesting premise. You'd be trapped as soon as you watch two episodes. Alright, so recently, Raekwon just dropped a new album, Shaolin vs. Wu Tang. For those who don't know, the title of his album is taken from the title of a classic kung fu movie called Shaolin vs. Wu Tang. One of Gordon Liu's early films. It's awesome. They kind of say Shaolin versus Wu Tang, but really, it's essentially about like a school, you know, the Shaolin, a break off, or basically a separate school. Really, most of all kung fu comes from the Shaolin, but break off and how they have different, you know, ideas on how things work, and they kind of pit together in the movie. And then they two, you know, basically two main characters team up against their foe, who somehow ends up finding a way to learn pieces of both sides, but master of neither. So the album kind of has a street Wu-Tang version of that storyline. It's not as good as Only Built for Cuban Links 2. But, it is a high point Wu album. Especially in this current, you know, new decade. Kind of weird Wu resurgence. I do like it more than Wu Massacre. Track with Nas is okay. The track with freaking Rick Ross and Ghost Called Molasses is yeah, that's good stuff. The track with Jim Jones and Ron Browns, pretty daggone good. Never thought I'd hear myself say that, but it is. You know, let's take a look real quick. What's the name of that song? Get that name for you. It's called Rock and Roll. It's dope. Overall good. Doing Busta Rhymes. Busta Rhymes is coming serious this year. Name of the track is called Crane Style. Busta spitting fire. Raekwon doing good things. Also in the rap game. Group from the West Coast. Pac Div came out with their new mixtape, Mania. Yeah, man, they've been on my radar for about 3 or 4 years now. I feel they probably is good new resurgence of the West, you know, along, you could say, with some of that more pop, kiddish rap of, you know, the new boys with the Jerk and to teach them how to Dougie. And, you know, there's good things going on with this Odd Future people. Pac Div is kind of more my way right now. I ain't really listened to Odd Future yet, but Pac Divi, on point. Some of my favorite tracks on that, you know, Super Negroes. You know, got a really good early 90s feel, you know. There's a Anti-Freeze. Good overall track. Real tough. Still a Knucklehead. That's a fun track. Chief Rocker. They go in on that Chief Rocker. All the beats are solid. The mixtape is hosted by Don Cannon. You don't know Don Cannon is a mixtape DJ. One time, you know, affiliated with DJ Drama. You know, you might know if you ever listen to him. You hear the Cannon. You know what I'm saying? You listen. You know, it's good. It's, you know, it's gonna have a DJ talking to certain parts. It's a really good mixtape. I'll probably be bumping through the whole spring. You know, it's free. You just go to Pac Div. Find them on the internet. You'll find it. Mixtapes are free, people. You know. Also, Most Def for me in a new song on Fuse. Can't buy this on iTunes yet. Can't even give it on the blog. It's called World Premiere. Whew. Oh, man. I can't wait for that new album to come out, man. He on that good music. You know, that's the name for Kanye's label. And man, I think he's gonna do a big song. So it's so fire. The beat is so excellent. It's like a perfect loop. His rhymes so intricate. It's like melodic to a certain degree. It's like a perfect tone. It's just, Mos Def is one of the sickest MCs out and completely underrated. I think it's because he be acting. I really do. Yeah, you know, that's a nice little music hit up. You know, I'm going to listen to some pop music soon. You know, listen to all the other stuff. You know, get back at you on that.
Girl, I'm a super negro, your dude's a zero. Baby, let me be your superhero. I spit that dope, that blow, that primo, that coke, that smack, that cappuccino. Girl, I'm a super negro, your dude's a zero. Baby, let me be your superhero. I spit that dope, that blow, that primo, that coke, that smack, that cappuccino. Girl, I'm a super negro, your dude's a zero. Baby, let me be your superhero. I spit that dope, that blow, that primo, that coke, that smack, that Al Pacino. Fly like Nino, tough like Debo. We back like TiVo, and fat like CeeLo. I drink cognac, I drink vino, shit, I drink all that. You should drink though. Grab a red cup, fill that shit up, and drink till you get a logo, hold your head up. I'ma act a fool, I don't know no better, but I never get a stain on this polo sweater.
As we work our way to the end of this episode, I want to drop you with a little bit of comic book I read. Name this comic book. It's Batman Incorporated number 3. You might know, I think the last time I talked about this comic, you know, number 2 was some episodes ago. Number 3 just came out. What more can I say? My man, Batman, is in Buenos Aires. Chilling, you know, teaming up with his man, El Guapo. I think, or Guacho. You know what? I'm doing this purely off memory, but roll with me. You know, there's this villain. He's a freaking parrot, a parrot cane, a crazy, like, face. He's beating up, I guess, this spy dude. Guacho coming on a motorcycle looking like Mr. Tough. He's got, like, a bandana wrapped around his head. I love the jacket, a shirt, and some pants, and some boots. Like, man, that's a superhero. And then Batman's off to the side coming in. They beating people up. They chatting. They escaping a freaking hot air balloon. Insanity. Yannick Paquette draws the hell out of this. It's crazy. Oh, it's utterly beautiful. Bruce Wayne goes to this man's house. This man's house. His secret identity. He's getting his secret identity on. You know, he's like the Argentinian. Friggin' Bruce Wayne. You know, he got nothing but fly women's around. Sipping on champagne. You know, that's a hood for champagne. You know, he got nothing but fine purse. Like the finest birds on earth. You know, chilling. He got this manly mustache. This nice sweater on. You know, looking fresh to death. Bruce Wayne come in. Look at his suit. So, look at me, I'm saying I'm Bruce Wayne, looking like a boss all the time. And then, you know, I guess the main chick El Guapo's working with is giving him static. So, Bruce take on the boss, and he drops a killer waltz. He draws all that. And it's crazy. It's crazy. It's a waltz of death. But, you know, Batman evades that because he's nice. So, after the waltz of death, these two, you know, Bruce Wayne, El Guacho, El Guapo, whatever. Argentinian Batman. You know, they have a little arguments. But you know. With that, first of all, it's funny because he's like, why, Batman, are you masquerading as Bruce Wayne? He clearly doesn't know. Bruce Wayne's Batman. So he must not be that bright. He got played just like everybody else. Batman's a boss. And, you know, they go after this villain that the chick they tried to do the killer waltz with. They end up going in. It's a death trap. Electro Nux fight to the death. Get out of it. Big villain. Luchador in a wheelchair. In a suit. With that chick dressed up in a bathing suit. And a scorpion helmet. That's all type of win. And that, my friend, means you should buy that comic. And it ends this podcast. Deuces.